This is a brief account of the third trip back to East Prussia for Inga. We started off in Hanover and of course wanted to go and visit Mutti's grave. It had been so well tended by Lilo, her very good friend. She looked after it every single week. Beautiful cemetery. Then we went and visited Mutti's house. It had been completely renovated since it had been sold, but much of the design was still as it was originally. Walking around the surrounding area, nothing much had changed in the years since she died. The next day, we start to meet all the other travellers. Many of them old friends. For me, making new acquaintances. So the trip wasn't boring because we were very well entertained. All these songs were the songs they used to sing when they were children. Some people even pretended to sing, didn't they, Leif? Travelling through Poland, the first night we stopped over in a hotel, and the next day we visited Marienburg, where the oldest brick castle in the world still stands. It's now called Malbork. Beautiful building, absolutely massive. And then back onto the coach. Poor Mariana, needing a hip replacement, needed to sit down as often as she could. All the commentary, of course, was in German. And then onto the outskirts of Königsberg. Noticing the very wide streets for such an old city. And this is the site where the Schloss once stood, the beautiful old castle, which of course the Russians razed to the ground and built this unbelievable building. Grateful to arrive at our hotel in Königsberg, Kaliningrad, as it now is. Dennis politely waited for everyone to get off the bus. A tour of the city and the old railway station. Much hadn't changed, but most things had really. Very much a Russian city now. Some of the old churches were still there. They obviously wanted to go and visit as many as they could. It was always emotional going back to the old places. Mum as tactile as ever. The commentary again, all in German. Amazingly, we met a Russian guide that had stayed with Inga in Torquay when he was learning English. And she saw him there taking a tour. Then came the all-important visit back to Schleiermacherstraße, the flat where she lived with her family on the top floor. This is always a particularly emotional time for her, going back to her childhood, the scene of so many events. Now seeing the building so dilapidated, it's quite hard to see for her. Right. Dennis and Mariana offering her lots of support and comfort. She visited her buildings where she grew up. Imagine going back to your secondary school after 50 years. Very little had changed. The internal of the building was still the same. This was the school where all this coach party went to. Back to the hotel for a nice libation. Then came the all-important train trip up to Raishan. This could well have been the platform they all escaped from at the end of the Second World War when they needed to leave. As ever, amber is on display wherever we go, and the clothes are very well priced. The most amazing lift I've ever seen. Just a two-man lift down to the beach. And I think it was holiday time when we were there because there were an awful lot of locals on the beach that day.
It must be a holiday, I think.
Amber again. When Inga was a little girl, she used to walk along the beaches and pick it up. The whole area is still rich in amber. As we continued our travels into the countryside, it's easy to see just how poor the people are. Then we visited one of the guide's apartments and she showed us how the ordinary Russian people live. She generously entertained us, introduced us to her family. The Lithuanian border was interesting to visit. This was a scene of many, many battles at the end of the Second World War as the Russians advanced into East Prussian territory. And here people are selling the most basic food on a wall at the side of the road. No fridges, raw meat, chicken, vegetables they've grown in their garden. Thankfully, we had our own lunch, hygienically prepared at the side of the road. Finally, we arrived.
This is Cow Cayman, the marketplace.
In Cow Cayman.
No, this is it.
This was where Inga's grandparents lived, Helena and Julius. The local church, the marketplace. Also known as Kukineza. And where her whole family emanated from originally. The trees were still there around the marketplace as they were 50 odd years ago. She knew exactly where she was going. She was finding her way to her grandparents' house. And there it was. Now divided into two or three houses, I believe. Once beautiful home with its picket fence. Fruit and vegetables in the gardens. Guide going in first to make sure it would be acceptable for Inga to pop in and say hello and see her old family home. Very poor, very humble people. They allowed us in. Incredible poverty. Her poor husband looked very bewildered and wondered what on earth everyone was doing, I think. Bless him. She desperately wanted to be hospitable and offer everybody a drink. Inga recalled the days when she used to play out in the garden. All the fruit and vegetables they used to grow. Dennis was invited to pick an apple from his great-grandfather's apple tree, which he did, because they had plenty.
Have they got children? Have they got
Everyone then frantically searched in their bags for something to leave them. And the lady, bless her, had gone upstairs and got changed into her best dress. Happy to be the centre of the photographs. Embarrassed to be living in Inga's grandparents' home. Very kind, very humble, and happy to share what little they had with us who visited. This lady desperately wanted us to follow her. She had something to show us.
Oh, look, she's showing me where she lives. Joe, Mac, show me all the chickens and the babies.
Oh,
look at them having a scratch. Oh, she's so proud of them. Oh, look at them all. They'll be coming out here in a minute.
Then the march back to the bus, where the children wait for sweets, pens, whatever we can give to them. One of the key destinations, of course, was to go to Krantz, sometimes spelt with a C, sometimes with a K. And this sat on the Baltic Sea in the north part of Prussia, East Prussia, and of course was where the hotel was situated. And they escaped from there on the night. They went across that sea, which was frozen, snow over the beach, where people were lining up to make their escape from the Russians, who were 20 minutes away. We spent a great deal of time looking for the spot where the hotel used to be. We knew it was no longer standing, but we simply just weren't far enough along the coast to where it actually was. So we just kept walking on the road that ran parallel to the sea, looking for where it might be. Amber trestle tables were everywhere, and this is an aviary, a centre where they were looking after wild birds, and everything was, all the narration of course was in German, but the birds were very cute. Mariana was happy to be holding a bird because she loved them so much. And then at lunch we had a nice beer and lots of fresh fruit and vegetables and salad. Catering was very good. This is just a roadside cafe that the coach stopped at.
Oh, tell them of us having lunch.
Exactly.
Say hello.
Hello.
That's good.
We're having lunch at the Tourist in the Road. No, that's kind of good.
What is that? It's very nice meal.
For our dinner.
Then back on the coach and off onto the beach along this wooden track and over that very strange staging that we had to walk over to get down onto the beach on the other side. It was a bit of a trek for some of the older members of the party. But the beaches held lots of memories for everybody, imagining what it was like on that night in January 1945. Now we arrive at Pilau, which is a strategic area for the Russians now, a naval post. And the day after we were arriving, Putin was planned to make a visit, so everywhere was very gleaming. And this was the spot that they had to make their crossing across the frozen ice of the sea in order to get to the Kuchenerum, the spit that ran down into Poland. Many warships stationed there.
Hello.
Very strategic area for the Russians. I think the statue may have had some significance, but I don't know what that was now. Many of the other statues were, of course, more recent and depicted events under Russian rule rather than East Prussian times.
That's where we cross the ice.
Yeah.
Mum then describes,
I mean, you look at it now as a very short,
how they made that trip,
you know, opening
over the sea.
But you walk across that.
It's a long way.
It's a long way, and when the people left and right drown in front of you, in the back of you,
It's a long, incredible long to imagine on a hot summer's day.
How much of the ice sort of remained, or how much was actually broken as people tried to get across it?
Well, it's just a big area, you see, so instead of making the short cut to get to the land, you had to go maybe across here to go to there, you know, because you looked for your little space where there was ice.
They walked across the ice, making sure they didn't go into an area where a horse and cart had already sunk in through the bottom into the sea. Already 600,000 people had left from there, mainly on boats, but those who were had left it late, like Ina and Mutti, had to make their escape across that water, across the frozen ice, dreadful weather conditions. Many never made it, because they wanted to take everything they owned on carts, which simply sunk through broken ice. I describe this quite vividly in the book. Now onto an amber mine. There are one or two amber mines. This was a large one.
Turn around the amber quarry.
Amber, even today, is quite prolific in the area. Great source of income now for the Russians. Those stalks were everywhere. This is a trip now back in Petersburg, making our way from the hotel to the port.
Yeah.
To board this boat.
Dues are the biggest load of cack that I have ever put on my feet.
You were grateful of them the other day. Make your mind up.
I was very grateful. I've walked straight out of them, Mariana.
That's exactly what I've done.
So my feet.
Hello. Got the U-boat.
Hello, yeah.
The painted one on
the toy U-boat.
For a trip around the docks and the port area. One of the key reasons that Hitler wanted to cross Poland, because this port doesn't freeze in the winter. Say that that was one of the key reasons why the Second World War started. As our little mafia boy waving us goodbye. Submarines there in evidence. And then, of course, we went under this bridge, which was a shock to us all when we realised that we were actually going to go under this bridge, which was only just a little bit higher than the railings of the boat.
Wow, that's going to be good, isn't it?
I mean, isn't it? Looking on that level, there's no space at all. And that plate that's hanging down.
It's always been, isn't it?
Like a Mexican wave, man.
You can see just how massive the dock area is. Lots of exports go from that point. And then on to our Russian evening. Yes, it was obligatory if you got involved. Even Dennis got dragged up. then, Max. And we dragged him back again, and he's beginning to look like he's enjoying it. Almost. Max is certainly getting into the same thing. Oh, Dennis is really enjoying himself now. He's going to there. Dennis has made his escape, feeling the heat. And there's Max going to sun for the grand finale. Sports. And here we are, the last day, packing up, waiting for the coach to arrive.
The three babushkas.
As Dennis says, the three babushkas, hoping for a small offering. Looks as though somebody's had a bit of a rough night.
Wonder who that is.
Comfortable.
Yeah, here's Cooley. Loading up in his normal, good-tempered way. Mind you, it's a bit of a bum job.
They're filming, Dan. A very emotional departure. Leaving Kingsburg for the very last time.
Sind dort raus, auch der Mädel hier.